Isn't it great to be together? Isn't it great to celebrate together? It feels so good. You know what? It is so good, and we don't realize initially how much good this is or how good it is or how much we've missed it because we as human beings are very social, and it's great to come together and be in the presence of one another and how important that is for our lives. It's valuable for our mental health, isn't it? You know, so many people have been sequestered over this past year. People have been removed from fellowship and connection with one another. It's affected the mental health of so many, and it's affected the spiritual health of so many. So it's important that we really get a chance to be together, to come together in community, and really to come together with people of like-mindedness. Now, we say this every Sunday, as we say, this is a place where people of like mind come together in Christ consciousness. We say this every Sunday, but sometimes we take it so lightly, not really understanding what it is we're professing or really embracing the wonderful energy that happens when we come together in like-mindedness, this like-mindedness of a Christ consciousness. And it is that we come together in this wonderful way of understanding and celebrating with one another. But we say Christ consciousness, and somebody say, wait, what does that mean? When you say Christ consciousness, well, first of all, we want to make sure that everyone understands Christ is not a man. I know many of you grew up Jesus Christ, assuming that Christ was the last name and he was the son of Mr. and Mrs. Christ, and we think that that's the last name of Jesus, but it is not. It is an acknowledgement of an awareness that Jesus embraced. You are the Christ, the disciples said. You are one who has awakened to this wonderful consciousness. This awareness, this understanding, this knowledge. We understand that this is not his last name, and it's not really describing anything other than the consciousness or character. So when we speak of someone's name, that we pray in Jesus' name, we pray in the character, or we're praying in the consciousness, the awareness that Jesus had. Jesus being our wonderful way shower, our master teacher, the one who has been our great example, showing us that we are called to have this very same consciousness or awareness that he had. So we're called then to be aware of the Christ within us or the Christ consciousness that we have. Jesus experienced it fully when in his baptism moment, there was this wonderful experience of him of acknowledgement, I am the beloved and God is well pleased. We have this wonderful word picture for us in the baptism experience that we want to visit over and over again of Jesus coming up from those waters of consciousness, coming up from the waters of awareness, coming up in this wonderful experience, and there a dove descending upon him and bringing forth this voice from heaven, this is my beloved in whom I'm well pleased. We too are called to have this experience on a regular basis where we waken to this wonderfulness that you are the beloved. God is loving you, and you are experiencing this wonderful love of God on a wonderful basis. And God is well pleased with you. Now, that's something that we don't often hear in church, that God's pleased with you. Quite often, there are churches today that are preaching, God's not pleased with you. God's not happy with you. You haven't been toeing the line. You haven't been doing X, Y, and Z. You haven't been following correctly. You haven't been doing exactly what God wants you to do. So God's not really pleased with you. And of course, what we don't understand theologically is that God gives us free will and choice, right? To choose. So God fully knew in the creative process that we would be people who would choose this or that, yes or no, to be positive or to be negative, to embrace truth or not to embrace truth. God knew that full well in the creative process. Yet we have created a theology that says, wait a minute, I give you free will choice, but if you're not choosing what I want you to choose, then I'm going to punish you or send you to hell. And we say, well, wait, what happened to free will? What happened that God giving us this opportunity to choose? And yet at the same time, there's then saying that God's not happy and God's not going to be pleased if you didn't do what God wanted you to do. You see, in the journey of our life, God gave us this freedom to choose to have a Christ consciousness, to choose this highest and best of understanding, to choose this enlightenment, to choose this. And the great rewards are there for us when we do embrace this wonderful choice, for when we have this Christ consciousness, the same awareness that Jesus had, when we allow this very mind of Christ to be ours, when we embrace that, wow, amazing things happen. For when we have this consciousness, when we embrace it, we begin to think from a new level of awareness that changes our day-to-day experience. We are then igniting a power within us. We're igniting an energy within us. Oh, wow. How many of you have ever experienced dynamite going off? Or maybe you've experienced a gun going off and felt the energy and the power of this release. Maybe you've experienced energy through, stepping on the gas pedal in your car, taking off. You've had all these wonderful moments where there's been an energy release. Well, this is what it's like when we embrace this Christ consciousness. We ignite an energy within us, a presence of God. For God is this infinite energy at work within us. We're igniting this wonderful power within the journey of our lives. And as we do, we're going to find an incredible transformation in our journey. For this power is in us. It's through us and around us. How do we know this? Well, let's look at Acts chapter 17, verse 28. It shows this. God intended that they would seek God and perhaps reach out for God and find God. Though he is not far from us. So the intention that we would be seekers of wanting to know more, wanting to have this personal experience of acknowledging and knowing that we are the sons and daughters of God, that we are beloved, and that God loves us, and that we might understand that to a higher level. And the verse goes on to, though God is not far from each one of us, because we know where God is, within, right? Well, that's not very far, is it? Wow, that is so close. God is within us. In fact, it goes on to say, for in him we live. For in this consciousness, for in this awareness, you wonder how you live? How are you existing right this moment? You're existing in the presence of God. You're existing. When I breathe in God. When I breathe out God. That's right. Peace, love, all describing this wonderful presence within us. How is it that we live? We live within this divine presence. That when your birth moment happened and you grasp that first breath of oxygen coming out of the womb and you the soul ignited with the body, you started breathing in this divine presence of God. You're living in this presence. It says, for in him we live and in him we move. How is it you're moving? How is it that you're actually, your body is moving within this world? How is it you find movement within? It's that wonderful energy, divine presence. It's this consciousness of God within us that's at work within us. And then it says, and we have our being, our very existence. Our very existence is this. When we welcome this experience within our life, we live in, through, around, and for this wonderful presence that we call God. We need to ignite this energy within us. We need to awaken to this Christ consciousness on a day-to-day basis. Now, it's amazing things happen when you find people of like-mindedness. It's a lot of fun to come together with people who think like you do, right? How wonderful that is to be in that kind of environment. You share ideas and commonalities. Oh, but it's really amazing when you come together with people of like-mindedness, a Christ consciousness, a very mind of God. This is what we find. We find people then who are in the mind of love. For God is love, right? Wow. Coming together with the people of the mind of love. You're thinking love. You're thinking love. You're radiating love. You want to radiate love. You're radiating love. You're doing this. How amazing it is when we then come together in this kind of environment. It's life transforming. It is truly igniting an incredible power. So I think it's really important that we begin by saying, I have the mind of Christ. I have this consciousness, okay? Say it with me, I have the mind of Christ. I have the mind of Christ. I'll say it like you believe it. I have the mind of Christ. That's right. I have this awareness. Say it with me. I have this awareness. I am thinking and moving in this mind. I am thinking and moving in this mind. I know that my very existence is in God. Say it. I know that my very existence is in God. Woo, what a proclamation you all are making. This is kind of exciting to know that we're people of like mind And there's an energy as we proclaim that which we know to be true. And we're fully aware. We're thinking in the mind of God. We're thinking in the mind of love. Wow, what a transformation that is. Because let me tell you this, how important it is. For the book of Romans chapter 15 says, now the God of endurance and the God of encouragement gives you a like-mindedness towards one another, calling us to have a like-mindedness towards one another. What is that like-mindedness? The mind of love. To have the mind of love towards one another. When I see you, I see love. When we walk into the room, we should ignite that power. That's right. How many of you walked in the room and felt like you made the room better because you were there? And how many of you walked into a room and felt like you made the room worse because you were there? You see, the calling in our life is to ignite this wonderful energy of this mind of love, this God presence within us that we're certainly, we walk in the room and the room feels changed because the presence of God has entered in a fresh new way. An additional energy or presence or revelation of God has now come into the room. And the room is transformed by one, two, three, presence of God or igniting powers. You're a stick of dynamite. You're a stick of dynamite. You're a stick of dynamite. That's right. And we're all exploding this morning. We're having this wonderful igniting power and presence as we celebrate together. And this is why it's so important that we come together in community with one another. 2 Corinthians chapter 13 says, finally, brothers, rejoice. Be perfected. Be comforted. Be of the same mind. Be of the same mind. Live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you. Coming into this sense of us all coming into a Christ consciousness and awareness. You're the Son of God. You're the Son of God. You're the daughter of God, the child of God. On goes the list. We all are fully aware of this. What happens is when we come into that wonderful, I am the revelation of God. Wow. And I came into this room to reveal God. And you came into this room to reveal God. We've got a lot of God going on here, don't we? A lot of the power and presence of God in this room. How igniting that is when we realize that's what we came to do. We came with this wonderful command or our mission, should we say, within our lives. Philippians chapter 2, verse 2 says, fulfill ye my joy, that ye may be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, being of one mind. Now, gathering with people of this incredible consciousness, this incredible awareness. Here's the amazing part. You know what? You gather with people who know who they are. You know what? Have you been with people who just, they don't even know who they are? They have this insecurity. They don't, the lack of confidence. They don't know who they are, not just as a person in this human world, but they don't understand that they are this child of God. They don't understand that they are heirs to all the goodness of God. They don't understand that God is pleased and working in and through them. Oh, but when you know who you are, you know what happens is you're not afraid. That's right. Wow. When we come with a group of like-minded people, fearless people, that's right. Fearless people who step out in holy boldness, begin to claim and know and walk in this wonderful confidence and assurance. They're not afraid because they're not in the world or they're in the world, but they're not of the world. That's why they're not afraid, because they're of a Christ consciousness, of an awareness of who they are, of an understanding of who they are as this child of God and what that means for them. So they're not afraid. So what we have is a room full, and those joining us through live streaming, those joining us through our YouTube channel, we're all being united together in this wonderful understanding. We are fearless because we know who we are. And it's great to be amongst a group like that, of people who have that kind of confidence. And you know what else? People of this like-mindedness know what they're capable of. That's right. A lot of us don't really know what we're capable of. We haven't really thought much about it. We don't understand our full potential. We don't understand the God-given abilities that are there within us, to be people who manifest, who create, who work miracles, that you are a person who is capable of moving mountains. That's right. Do you understand that? When you are in Christ consciousness, you understand Jesus was able to do the miraculous, and he expects you to do the same. He was the great example, showing you the way for you to be the mountain mover that you're called to be and that you're capable of being. You are capable of moving mountains. But when we come into that Christ consciousness, when we come together, we find a room full of people who say, wow, let's move some mountains together. Let's begin to pray for one another. Let's begin to believe with one another. Let's begin to encourage one another. Let's begin to support one another, because we know that we are capable. In our Christ consciousness, we know who we are and we know what our potential is and what our abilities are. And we know what we're called to do. We know what we're called to do. We know who we are. We know what we're capable of. But we know that we're called to do, that we are called to be builders and edifiers of the body, lifting up one another, building up one another, strengthening one another, encouraging one another. I hope not a one of you will leave this room today without feeling some sense of encouragement or some sense of being built up or being edified within the body. Because that's what we're called to do. When we gather together, what we're called to do is ignite this wonderful energy of this presence of God, share it with one another. Let this power and presence flow from us, out from us, through us, and around us, so that one another might feel this sense of being edified and built up. The Apostle Paul told the Romans and the church in Rome to help one another, especially the stronger, to assist the weak. That's right. Well, we may have, shall we say, babes in Christ, newborns who are just newly starting out on their spiritual journey. And our calling is for those who have walked this pathway of spiritual enrichment, enlightenment, to help the weak, to help that the stronger be there to help the weaker. Let us be there with words of encouragement and support, not condemnation. Doesn't say that. Not judgment. We can find churches that are full of judgment, full of condemnation. But that's not what we're called to do. That's not the work of the people of Christ consciousness. That's not the work of the people of God. Our work is to build up, edify, support, and encouragement. For our life and our words of love and comfort prove that we understand the glory of God. Our life and our words of comfort to one another will prove that we truly understand, that we truly get this. So our words should always be edifying, building up. And we are called then to be the ones who are creating a world that works for everyone, not just a few. That's our calling. So we're creating this loving environment. We're creating this supportive environment. We're creating this world that's where people feel positive reinforcement, where they feel encouragement in the Spirit of God, where they begin to feel the love of God flowing from you to them. How important that is. Have you really radiated the love of God today? I hope you just wake up in the mornings and your intention is, I want to be radiating. I want to be putting out this wonderful energy of the love of God. I want everyone who I'm encounter with to experience this. So we need to get into the business of building up, not tearing down. Not tearing down. So we need to say, who and how have we built someone up today? Have we said, I see the good in you. I see the God in you. I see the love in you. You see, that's really important. And I think we need to do a little building up right here and now. So let me just say, turn to the person next to you and say, I see the good in you. Oh, I think you do better than that. Come on, proclaim it. I see the good in you. That's right. Now turn to the person on the other side of you and say, I see the God in you. I see the God in you. That's right. And how about you build someone up by saying, I see the love in you. I see the love in you. That's right. And for those of you joining us, we're saying this together for you who are joining us through live streaming and joining us through our YouTube channel. I see the love in you. I am building you up with the words of comfort and support and strength. When you may feel weak and weary, that's when we need to assemble together, come together, and allow the stronger to support the weaker, to allow those who have great faith to lift us up and encourage us. When we're weak and weary, to turn to one another, brothers and sisters in this family of God, to say, lift me up, encourage me, help me, support me in the journey of believing and going through this life together. Because let me tell you this and remind you. Did you know thoughts are energy? And we're igniting energy through our thoughts. We're igniting energy through the thoughts of, I'm loving you. I'm seeing good in you. Not only speaking it, but thinking it. Because you got to think it first before you speak it. Hopefully, you're thinking through what you're saying. Uh-huh. That's right. So we think it, and that thought energy comes, and then we give voice to it. I see the good in you. I see the amazing power of God in you. These thoughts are energizing within us. And this is what we're called to do as a body of believers. Let's look at the story of Naaman in the Old Testament. Naaman was a military leader who had a condition in his body. And he turned to the prophets seeking out a recipe for healing. What can I do for healing? Thinking as him being an important leader, certainly I'll just go to the prophet. And the prophet will say, yes, here it is. You know, I'll pray this prayer and you're just fine. Go your way. Because, hey, he was an important man. He felt like certainly the recommendation or the recipe for healing is going to be just easy and smooth for me. And when he went to the prophet said, here's what you do for your healing. Go to the River Jordan and dip 7 times. What? Do you know who I am? I'm a military leader. I'm a person of importance. You're asking me to go down to the muddy waters of the River Jordan and get in that skanky river and get in all that mess like the Chattahoochee, you know, where you want me to dip in that? No, I ain't going in that waters. You want me to get down in there and dip all the way down? Could I just tip my toe? No. Could I just put a foot in? No. You want me to dip in this? Do you know who I am? Excuse me. Do you know who I am? I'm a military leader, and you're asking me to do this? What does he do? Finally, in obedience to the direction given to him by the prophet, he goes down to the River Jordan. He dips, you know, once. Okay, nothing's happening. Twice. Really? I got to dip again? 3 times. Are you sure? 4 times. Dipping all the way down. 5 times. 6 times. And the 7th time he comes out with healing. Now this story, is it about dirty, mucky waters healing? If it was, we'd all be down at the River Chattahoochee River right now looking for some healing power if dirty water was the secret. That's not what it is. The story has a powerful message for us. For waters throughout Scripture in metaphysical understanding have always symbolized the flow of thought. Here is the River Jordan flowing in a wonderful thought process. And he's called to take that weakness, that sickness, that belief that he is not whole, to dip into those waters of cleansing that may remove and flush out any thoughts that you are not whole, you are not well, you are not healed. And to do that 7 times. Why? Why the number 7? Why not 6.5? Why not 4 times? How about just once? Really? Do I have to dip 7 times? 7 means you dip until it's completely done. 7 is the number of completion or perfection in Scripture. So the symbolism there is we dip into the thought process. We dip into this wonderful energy. We dip into this wonderful knowing that we provide, for there's a river of thought right here of God is good all the time God is good. River of thought going through this room, and for those connected with us, was expressing this wonderful healing and wholeness, a Christ consciousness, an awareness that says, I know all things are good, and I'm dipping into it. I'm dipping all the way down. I'm going in. I'm letting that thought cover me up. I am surrounded in. I am immersed in it. I am so far into it, and I'm going to do it and do it again and again and again until it's complete. Until I've been so immersed that I realize my wholeness, my healing, my wellness, my completeness. Because it wasn't the water. It was the consciousness. It was the willingness to step forward and do and to say, I accept this healing and I'm going to dip in it. You know, the water's like a placebo, you know? Ever have those placebo effects in your life where someone gives you a sugar pill and someone else gets the real pill, you know, and you both believe you got the real thing? And those who've gotten the placebo or the sugar pill go, I'm healed and I'm doing well, you know, and the person finds out only later that you just had a placebo, but you began to believe. You see, it's the power of us believing. It's not about the water. It's about believing in a consciousness of thought that says, I understand when I assemble together with this crowd of believers, of like-minded people, there is an energy in this room, a presence of God that's being ignited because of you, and the love that you have, and the mind of God, the mind of love that you're sharing in your consciousness right now that says, all things work together for good. Woo! We're in the waters of good thought. We're in the healing waters right now. Let's just dip in. Let's get that consciousness all around us. Let's splash it up on us. Let's splash it up on one another. That's right. Let's just play in the waters of Christ consciousness, of an awareness. Because when this mind is in us, it's the mind of God. And that thinking is thinking as God does. And when we do that, we ignite an incredible energy and a power that's ignited within our lives. You know, the scripture says when two or three gather together in my name, it's when two or three gather together in my character. It's when two or three gather together in the consciousness. It's when two or three gather together in the Christ consciousness. It's when two or three are gathered together in like-minded. That's what it's saying for us. When we gather in this, there it says, there I am among them. And how important it is that sometimes when your faith is weak and when your faith is weak and when you've had a tough week and you're feeling like you've been knocked over, the wind blown out of your sails, someone else in fellowship and in the house of God in church on Sunday morning lifts you up. And where two or three are gathered together, you're gathered in this wonderful presence. The love of God in you is reinforcing the love of God in me. The love of God in you is reinforcing the love of God in him. And so on it goes. And what we're doing is we are igniting this powerful presence, taking it up to another level. That's right. We're taking it up to a higher level. For Matthew 18 says, again, I tell you truly that if two of you on earth agree, come into Christ consciousness together, be in like-mindedness, anything you ask for, it will be done for you by the divine source or the Father in heaven. Having this like-mindedness that we share when we come together is igniting an incredible power. It's important that we come together. Now, over this past year, we've done our best to reach out to everyone through live streaming and through our YouTube channel. We've done our best to stay connected. Now is the time for us to return and to not forsake the assembling of ourselves. That's right. That's biblical. The Bible says, do not forsake the assembling of yourself. Do not forsake coming together in the community of love. Do not forsake coming together into the rivers or the waters of Christ consciousness. Don't forsake that. It's essential for your spiritual life. We gather together not because of some doctrine or tradition. We gather together for a purpose, to build up one another, to ignite one another, to celebrate, that's right, celebrate the goodness of God. And when you're celebrating, woo, I get caught up in the celebration power that you're igniting. You know, you're celebrating, I'm celebrating, we're all celebrating. Before you know, the energy gets going, right? How many of you walked into a room where a party's going on and the celebration spirit is going on and they're dancing and they're having a good time and they're laughing and enjoying one another? And you know what happens? It gets catchy, doesn't it? Before you know it, you're getting in there. You're hearing the music. You're getting your groove on. I know. I've seen you kind of shake it a little bit. Say, okay, I'm feeling happy now. I'm feeling good. I'm getting the celebration spirit. I'm feeling it now. It's happening. Yeah. And before you know it, you're caught up in it. That's what we're called to do. I don't know what kind of week you've had. I don't know exactly the journey you've been through. But if you've been weary and worn down and beat down, and you're feeling like you need a little celebration, open your heart up to the Christ consciousness that's flowing in this room. And for you joining us, knowing that that Christ consciousness is available to touch your life and to minister to your life, when we come together in this like-mindedness, amazing things happen to us. And let me tell you this one more thing. How many of you have been to a concert, the live experience? You've been to a game. You were at the Super Bowl, you were in the stadium, whatever it may be, you're in that environment, and you go home and say, you had to be there. Oh, but I watched it until, oh, you had to be there. Oh my, the concert was so amazing. Did you see this? Oh, well, I was watching on television. No, you didn't have the energy. Did you get part? Were you dancing with the music? No, I was watching it on television. Were you see that when that touchdown happened? Were you there when the crowd jumped up and roared? You had to be there. And that's exactly the same thing. We're coming to church, and I know it's great to connect through us through television for some of you who can't, or through live streaming, or through whatever vehicles we may have, or in social media. I think it's great. But nothing's going to replace the experience, personal, of coming together in the body of Christ and sharing in Christ's consciousness, igniting the energy in one another of the divine power and awareness of God. You had to be there because it's electric when you're in the presence of God expressed in each and every one. When I'm in your presence, I feel your love. When I'm in your presence, I feel the divine being expressed. When I hear your words of grace, peace, and love, they're building up and edifying one another. So the scripture says, forsake not. In other words, it's saying, let's get it together. Come on, folks. Let's come together. Let's turn on out. Certainly now the COVID-19 pandemic is moving into a new phase where people are expressing this wonderful confidence. And as we move in this confidence, it's time for us to celebrate together and to build up. To build up in this wonderful manner. It says, exhorting and encouraging one another. Ooh, I'm ready for some encouragement. How about you? I'm ready for this wonderful power of love that flows from one another. It says, you can do it. I believe it. I'm encouraging you. Amazing things are working through you. I see God flowing through you and in you. I hear the wonderful impact that the Spirit of God has had upon your life. I listen to your words and your testimony. It's so encouraging. I love it. Are you ready? Let's celebrate. Are you ready to ignite the power and presence of God in a new way? Let's continue coming together and let's make that our purpose. Not because we have to, or some dogma says, I grew up, you had to come to church. You come to church to do our spiritual work. That's right. Not because we have to. Not because it's something that if you don't go to church, God's not going to be pleased. Not because of that. But we come to experience this power that's igniting within us. This power that is electric. This power that edifies, builds up, and encourages in the love of God. Amen.